Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
I'm going to get down on my knees and let's go before the Lord together in prayer today. Father, we're grateful to come into your house today. Lord, we just praise you and we honor you in this place, God. We thank you for your presence that's already here, God. And we love you, Lord. Today, God, as we open up your word, we pray that you open it up to us and open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown. May it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Holy Spirit, be welcome in this place. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, even the direction and the correction that we need for our lives. We give you the praise. May that word fall on good ground, God, our hearts. May it penetrate deep into the core of our being, Lord. May it take root, God, and we'll do our part. Give our interest, give our attention, God. We receive it with meekness this day. We profess, God, and we pray that that word would produce fruit to the glory of God. Lord, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves. Also, we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. We ask that you bless them this day, God, and be amongst them as you be amongst us. God, we ask for all of our brothers and sisters, Lord, for the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. God, we thank you for Calvary Chapel and Harvest, God, for the Well and the Way, for Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, all the great churches that are out there, Lord, too many to name by name, God. We bless our Catholic brothers and sisters, Adventist brothers and sisters, Lord. We bless the Four Square denominations, God, and the Assemblies of God, Lord, for Victory, God, and all the great churches that are out there. We bless them as you bless us in Jesus' mighty name. And Lord, we remember our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered throughout the nations, God. Be near to them and encourage them, lift them up and deliver them. For it's in Jesus' mighty name we're all in agreement. We say,
amen.
Amen. Today, get your Bibles out. Go with me once again to the wonderful chapter of Hebrews, chapter 10. We're going to be in the last verse of Hebrews, the 10th chapter. We've been in Hebrews, the 10th chapter, quite some time now. And today we're going to wrap up Hebrews, the 10th chapter. Next time we get together in the book of Hebrews, like I mentioned before, will be next year, 2015, early part of January. We're going to be going into Hebrews, the 11th chapter, starting in verse number 1, talking about faith. Going to be good, and I'm excited about that. But I believe that the Lord has a specific word for us today. Title of today's message is this: Direction for Life. Direction for life. We'll find out what that means as we go through. Hebrews 10th chapter, verse number 39. Let's take a look at it together. It says, "But we are not of those who draw back to perdition, but of those who believe to the saving of the soul." Now, I want to point out something in these verses. We've been talking about drawing away from or getting closer to God. You remember last week when we were together, Pastor Luke brought a great message about things that will either draw us closer to God or draw us away from God. Now, Hebrews, the 10th chapter, I've highlighted some words and I want to point them out to you because I want you to see the direction that these words are pointing. First of all, we are not of those who draw back to. Everybody say, draw back to.
Draw back to.
See, that's a direction that people are going. Some people draw back in a direction to something. They draw back to what? To perdition. But of those who believe to, everybody say, believe to. Once again, we're believing to something. There's a direction for our faith in our lives. Now, we study from the Old King James and from the Greek and the Hebrew, obviously, but it's a reliable translation. We preach and teach from the New King James for ease of understanding. But from time to time, we pull out different translations. And today, I'm going to bring some different translations, even some paraphrases, that will help to expand our understanding in the things of God. So I want to show you Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse number 39, in the New Living translations. Look at what it says up on the overheads for you. It says this: "But we are not like those who turn away from God to their own destruction." Remember that word perdition? Maybe you were going, what is perdition? Perdition is destruction. We're not those who turn away from God. Notice the direction that these people are going. They are no longer going toward God. They are turning away from God to their own destruction. But look at the next sentence. It says, "We are the faithful ones." Everybody say, the faithful ones. We are the faithful ones whose souls will be saved. We are those who believe to the saving of our souls. Now, that word faithful is a great word because the original word really is faith, pistis, in the Greek. And when I think about faithful, when I think about something that is true and it's faithful, you can count on it every time. Think about it like this. If I was getting direction and I needed to go north, right? What would I do? I'd go out and I'd get a compass. If I had a compass in my hand right now and every time I looked at that compass, it was pointing north, I could turn to the west and it'd be pointing north. I could turn to the south, it'd be pointing north. I could turn to the east and it would be pointing north. I could say that that compass is a faithful compass, couldn't I? Is that right? It's okay to talk to me today. Hopefully you came to church to participate and not just spectate, okay? So would that be a true statement that that's a faithful compass? Yes, it would be. So if I had a compass, though, and if every time I looked at that compass, it was pointing a different direction, right? I would turn west and it would turn east. I would turn north and it would turn south. I would turn east and it would turn north. See, I would say this thing is unfaithful. It's not true. It's not pointing north, and I can't rely on it. And what's it doing? It's turning away to its own destruction. Why? Because I'm going to throw that thing in the trash. That's not doing me any good. I might as well go by the sun or the North Star or something like that, because that's faithful. It's going to be there for me, whereas that compass wouldn't be. See, our lives, we need to get direction in our lives. And the compass for our lives is literally the Word of God. It is tried. It is true. It is faithful. It's always pointing to true north. It's always pointing us to God. It's always pointing us in the right direction. And so our faith now is the guide that gives us the direction. When you believe the Word of God, now you can point in the direction that God has for you. See, your destination is going to determine your course. And if you're wanting to go in the direction of God, that destination is going to determine that I'm going to go in this direction. So faith is that guide that's going to guide us and give us the direction for life. Are you listening today? Philippians, the third chapter, great section of scriptures, very familiar verses in Philippians, the third chapter. Turn there with me. Philippians chapter 3, we're talking about we are not those who turn away from God. We're not those who draw back to perdition. But we are those who believe to the saving of our souls. We got the right direction in life. The Apostle Paul writes in Philippians, the third chapter, verse number 13 and verse number 14. He's building on our understanding. We're going somewhere today. Philippians, the third chapter, verse number 13 says this. He says, "Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended. But one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." So what is he saying? Really, what he's saying is just about the same thing as what we just read in Hebrews, the 10th chapter, verse number 39. He says, I'm not drawing back to perdition. I'm not going back towards that old life or that old way, which leads to destruction. That leads me down. It leads me the wrong way. It leads me back. But I am pressing on towards, I am believing to the saving of my soul for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Today, I see two things that in our life gives us direction for life. You know, oftentimes we'll give you three things, four things, sometimes five things, you know, to remember. Today, I got two that the Apostle Paul gives us here in Philippians, the third chapter. And the Apostle Paul is so interesting when you study his life, because look at who's saying this. This is a man who, just a chapter before in Philippians chapter 2, was talking about himself. He says, if anybody had reason to boast in the flesh, I did. I mean, I could trace my lineage back to Benjamin. I was a Hebrew of Hebrews. I was a scholar. I was a Pharisee. That means he held to the strictest form of the law. People looked at him and they thought he had it going on. He wore the right clothes. He walked the right walk. He talked the right talk. And yet, all of that stuff was leading him in the wrong direction. In fact, he said, I count all that stuff as dung. It's all lost for the cause of Christ in my life. And so he says, my direction now has changed. No longer am I going towards that destruction, those dead things. Now I'm going on with God. I press towards the goal for the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. In our life, two things, the direction for life that I see in these verses. First one is this. Number one, the direction for life. We've got to get past our past. Are you listening today? We've got to get past our past. We cannot live in the past. Oftentimes I hear people talking about the glory days. Listen, that was yesterday. Today is a new day. And God is looking at what you're doing with your life right now. He's not interested in the football quarterback star or the prom queen or any kind of stuff. Listen, this is not about how great it was back then. This is about what God is doing with us. And I don't want to live focused on my rearview mirror, because I'm going to run into the wrong thing. I'm going to get the wrong direction. So I got to focus ahead on what God has for me right here and right now. What is coming my way? And in our lives, we got to get past that old man. We got to get out of that sin nature and get into the God nature. Now we've been given a new nature. Now Jesus Christ lives on the inside of us. Now we've been born again. And that old man's gone and dead. And yet many times as I look at the lives of Christians, I say, my goodness, look at them and look at the world. There's no difference. Look at we're supposed to be a peculiar people. There's supposed to be something different about us. What's wrong? We're still living like the old man. In Romans, the 6th chapter, starting in verse number 1 through verse number 3, in the Message, okay, again, this is a paraphrase, but I like the way that he explained this because it broadens our understanding. Romans, the 6th chapter, starting in verse number 1, he says, what do we do? Keep on sinning so God can keep on forgetting it? See, a lot of times I hear people, well, the grace of God's going to cover that. If I mess up, it's okay. Well, yeah, God will forgive you, but don't abuse that privilege. God's also not dumb. So should we just keep on sinning so God can keep on forgiving? Look what he says. I should hope not. Now look at this. If we've left the country where sin is sovereign, how can we still live in our old house there? Or didn't you realize we packed up and left there for good? That is what happened in baptism. When we went under the water, we left the old country of sin behind. When we came up out of the water, we entered into the new country of grace, a new life in a new land. See, we got to get that mentality that even though, you know, sometimes people say, well, you can take the boy out of the city, but you can't take the city out of the boy. Well, listen, if that boy dies and there's a new boy, then listen, it's not that old man any longer. I'm not that old person. I'm not that old sinner. I'm not doing the things that I used to do any longer. Why? Because I packed up and I left. I'm gone from that place. Kind of funny thought. I was thinking about this. And there were 2 years of my life. At one point in my life as a teenager, I went through a place called Tulsa, Oklahoma. And as I went there, I spent one night there, and the next day as I was leaving, I looked around and I said, God, I am never coming back here again. Now, little did I know, God had planted a Bible college there and a church there that he had called me to go and attend Bible college. So I ended up living in Tulsa, Oklahoma for 2 years of my life. And God was kind of saying, oh, really? You know, you're not going to come back? You know, we'll see about that. You just wait. So here I am, I'm living in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and my wife and I, and we're driving, you know, and it was really strange. You know, it's like going to a different country. I don't know. I love the people of Tulsa. Don't get me wrong. If anybody's watching on the live stream from Tulsa, bless you, and may the Lord just cause his face to shine upon you. And God, I'll go anywhere you want me to go, but I just, you know, submit. And I've been there, and I don't want to go back there, but that's just me. But when we're there, we're driving, right? And everything's different. People are different, you know. It's a lot slower. Californians, we're kind of wired differently, you know. We're all a little bit ADD. There's so much to do, so much to see, you know. An hour to the mountains, an hour to the beach, a couple hours to San Diego, an hour to the desert, you know. And we got all these options, and we're all kind of high-strung, you know. And when we're driving, man, California drive. Even think about our stops, right? California stop. They say that for a reason, you know. Some of you are painfully aware of a California stop because you had a police officer tell you you just did one. But in Tulsa, when they're getting onto the freeway, they're getting ready to merge onto the freeway, they get to the end of the on-ramp and they stop and look over their shoulder to see if it's okay for them to merge. First time I encountered this, my wife and I are driving, we're getting on the freeway and we're accelerating and this person stopped in front of us. You know, and we're going, and the person in front of us is looking in their rearview mirror like, who are you? You know, what are you doing? I'm waiting to get on. Wait your turn. Oh, California plates. Oh, that's what it's all about. So they merge on and we're on their tail, you know, like, ah. Now listen, I had to adapt while I was there. And I had to slow down and stop at the end of the on-ramp. And even when I was merging, if I didn't slow down and stop, people would be looking at me funny, telling me I'm number one and all that kind of stuff, you know. And so I had to change the way I lived while I was there. Now, what if when I came back to California, if I was here at church today and I left and I was getting on the 10 and I started to act like I was still living in Tulsa, Oklahoma? There'd be a 5-car pileup right there on the end of the on-ramp, right? A bunch of you guys there telling me I'm number one. No. It's that other church. Not you guys. But see, why would we still want to live in sin any longer? Why would we want to live like the old man? Why would we want to continue to act like we used to act? No, you've been given a new nature. Now you live in a new land. Now your destination has changed. Your activity has changed. Your mind has changed. Your heart has changed. And now you are a new person in Christ Jesus. J.B. Phillips, in his New Testament paraphrase of Romans 6, says, "Let us never forget that our old selves died with him on the cross, that the tyranny of sin over us might be broken. For a dead man can safely be said to be immune to the power of sin." I absolutely love that statement. "And if we were dead men with him, we can believe that we shall also be men newly alive with him." What does that mean? See, if you took a gun and you went to a casket and opened it up and pointed it at a dead person's head and said, "Give me all your money," what kind of response are you going to get? None, right? In the same way, when sin comes knocking at your door and points a gun at you and says, "I want you to do my will," no response. Why? Because I'm dead to sin, but I'm alive to Christ. I've left that old land. Sin no longer has power over me. I am free to do the will of God. Romans chapter 6, verse 4 in the New King James Version, "Therefore, we were buried with him through baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life." You gotta get past your past. You gotta forget that old man. Not that you forget all your memories and all of your life before Christ, no, but that your memories no longer have power over you. Are you listening today? One other thing to get past our past, see, there's pains that we bring from our past into our present. And the way to get rid of those pains is through the power of forgiveness. Through forgiveness. If you're gonna get past your past, you gotta forgive. You have to let it go and give it to God and say, "God, I'm forgiven." You gotta forgive other people, people who have hurt you, people who were close to you, people who betrayed you, people who you thought could never do any wrong, and now all of a sudden they're the ones who hurt you the deepest. Mom, dad, brothers, sisters, uncles, family members, relatives, friends, best friends, spouses, children, coworkers, neighbors, people in our life. See, we've gotta forgive, we gotta let it go. We gotta forgive ourselves. Listen, if God can forgive you, then you need to forgive you. Don't hold on to that old hurt. "Oh, Pastor, you don't know what I did. I knew better and I still did it." And God knew you were going to do it and he still went to the cross. And we got to forgive. Hallelujah. We got to forgive God. You say, "God, why would we forgive God? Perfect. Why would I forgive God?" Here's why. Because you didn't understand. And you didn't know why that happened. And you're holding God responsible for your hurt and your pain. Got to let it go. You got to say, "God, you are just no matter what happens on the earth. And so, God, I release this bitterness in my heart towards you. God, I just give it to you." You know what unforgiveness is like? Unforgiveness, who can I pick on today? Let's see. I've already picked on Dr. Becker. Let me pick on Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a great man of God. Love Pastor Joel. He's definitely a friend, and we can talk and that sort of a thing, shared meals together and different things. Pastor Joel, he has an office right across from my office. Oftentimes, he'll come in, we'll talk ministry, talk discipleship, talk the word, and that sort of a thing. Let's say one day, Pastor Joel comes into my office, and he has a tack in his hand. He says, "Pastor Dan, I'm going to give this to you." I say, "Okay," and so I reach out my hand, and he takes that tack, and he shoves it sharp end right into the palm of my hand. Now, I'm going to be like, "Ow!" Right? Okay, so, and let's say I grab onto that, and I say, "Pastor Joel, why would you do this to me?" And he says, "Well, that's just how it is," and he walks out and goes back to his office. Now, unforgiveness is like me saying, "You know what, I'm so mad at Pastor Joel. I'm not letting this go. You know what, I'm not gonna forgive. I'm gonna hold on to this and I'm just gonna make him pay." Now let me ask you something. Him sitting over there in his office laughing it up, is he hurting? Or am I hurting? See, unforgiveness is holding on to that pain. But the moment I say, "You know what, I'm gonna forgive him," and I release the offense, now even though I may remember what he did, it no longer has power to cause me pain in my life. Are you listening? See, we've got to forgive. We've got to move past the hurts. We've got to release it to the Lord and forgive. And if you need to ask for forgiveness, you've got to do that too. I know it's tough, but you can do it. Ephesians, the fourth chapter. Turn there with me. Ephesians, the fourth chapter. You're there in Philippians. Turn a book back to Ephesians chapter 4. Last verse in Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 32. Take a look at the instructions we get from the Apostle Paul once again. Ephesians 4, chapter verse number 32. It says, "And be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another." Pastor Dan, how do I do that? You don't understand the hurt. You don't understand the pain. You don't know what they did to me. How can I forgive those people? How can I forgive God? How can I forgive myself? Here's how. Even as God in Christ forgave you. You cannot give what you do not have, but if you have received the forgiveness of God in your life, now you have the grace of God, the power of God, the ability of God to release that hurt and to give it over to the Lord and to heal from those past hurts. You can get past your past. Are you listening today? God is good. Direction for life, number one, is get past your past. Number two, second thing for us today, and I like this one. Not only forgetting what's behind, but pressing on towards the prize for the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Number two is press for the prize. We need to press on. We need to get past our past, but then our direction is moving forward now. I'm going in the direction God has called me to. I've got my eyes on Jesus. My faith is set. My focus is set now. I've got that true north. I know what I'm to do, and now I am pressing for the prize. See, backsliding is easy. It takes no effort, and you will have no resistance from the flesh. Is that true? Right? All you got to do to backslide is stop pressing. Just stop. And eventually, you'll find yourself drifting away from God in the current of life. Backsliding is easy, but we need to press on. We are not of those who draw back to perdition or destruction. We are those who believe to the saving of the soul. That's what this is all about. That's why we get into church. That's why we find out what the will of God is. Why? Because we're adding things to our life each and every time. I know what I'm to do now. I've got the direction of God for my life. I know how I need to live. I know how I should walk. I know what I can do. And we get that direction. We get that true north. And then we press in that direction. And listen, God doesn't make it hard for us. Can I tell you something? God is not mean-spirited up in the heavens going, I'm asking them to get close to me, but how can they do it? They're a bunch of fools. They don't know what they're doing. How can they get to me? I'm all the way up here in heaven. They're down there on earth. It's impossible. No, that's not God. God makes it incredibly simple for us. The Bible tells us that if we will draw near to God, that God will draw near to us. So if you're pressing towards the prize, see, the prize is God himself. Prize is the presence of God in your life. And if you feel like, where's God? I'm so distant from God. God is saying, just come. See, you may have walked 1,000 steps away, but it only takes one step to get back, because the moment you start to draw near to God, God draws near to you, and God has bigger legs. It's right there. Go to God. Take it to him. Take it to him. Say, God, I feel distant. God, will you be near? Will your presence fill me? Fill my house. Fill my life, God. See, we are disciples of Jesus Christ. Why do I bring that up? Because a disciple is a disciplined follower of Jesus Christ. There's been a new term for Christians called Christ follower, and it's a cool term because that's really what we're doing. We are disciplined followers of Jesus Christ. And we are pressing towards the prize. You know, that's really an athletic term. It talks about the disciplines that an athlete... See, an athlete doesn't eat whatever they want to eat. An athlete gets up early and stays up late, so that they can train, so that they can run, so that they can do, and they don't get involved in other things. They're focused here. And for us, we need to discipline our lives, but we don't like that word discipline. But you cannot live a Christian life without discipline. You're gonna have to put the flesh under, get past your past, so that you can press on towards the prize. And we wanna win that prize. That's what this is all about. I want to obtain the prize. How do I do that? Remember, God makes it incredibly simple. The disciplines of the Christian life are simple. They're easy. You probably heard them. When you were born again, somebody came and told you, now that you're a Christian, here's what you need to do. You need to pray. You need to talk to God. Pastor, I don't have hours to pray. If you don't got hours, take the minutes. Spend it throughout your day. Take some time. Lord, I just give you this day. God, I just set myself aside for your holy purposes. God, you're in control. As you're doing the bills, Lord, I pray that you help me to be a wise steward. God, just give me the wisdom that I need right now. As you're on the job, God, may I work to the glory of God. You're my boss, Lord. Give me the strength and the energy I need today. As you're there in the home, setting up the table for the family, and you're praying for the meal, God, thank you that you provide. See, you pray. You stay in constant communication with God. Take some time. If you have the time, take the time and pray. Turn the TV off. Average American spends 3 hours a day on television, wasting away our life. Don't tell me you don't got time to pray. Go pray. Take some time. Study the Word. Pastor, I don't understand Scripture that much. I can't read that good. That's okay. Get a little bite. That one little bite will do as much for you as devouring a big old chunk. Early on in my Christian walk, I was raised up and I thought that I had to read chapters each and every day just to be spiritual or just to, you know, and I remember the first year of my Christian walk, I read through the whole Bible in 8 months, and when I got to the Amen in Revelation, I said, what on earth did I just read? Anybody know what I'm talking about? You know, and for my lifetime, I've been reading through the Bible, and every time I read through it, there's something new. There's something that I didn't realize. There's something that I didn't see. There's something God's bringing new and fresh, or an old verse that God has put a new spin on in my life, and now I understand it in a different way. See, you don't need a big old chunk. You don't have to gorge yourself. See, the Bible says and talks about the manna that the children of Israel gathered. He who gathered much didn't gather too much, and he who gathered little had more than enough. So in our lives, if all you got time for is one scripture in the morning, get that scripture. Chew on it. Talk about it with your family. Talk about it with your coworkers. Bring your Bible to church. Read it again at your lunch hour. Put it on a little note and post it when you're brushing your teeth or on the dashboard of your car so that when you're driving, man, all of a sudden you've got every stop sign. You can get the Word of God in your heart and bring it up over. It's a discipline of your life. What about this one? Fellowship. Coming into a corporate setting, coming into church attendance. You thought it was just church. It's just religion. That's just religion, Pastor. No, that's a custom that we have that helps us to draw near to God. Because there is a corporate anointing in this place that when the saints gather together, there God is in the midst of those two or more gathered in His name. There Jesus is in the midst. Jesus is here. He's present. He's speaking to His church. And as you're taking notes, my goodness, if you haven't heard the voice of God in your prayer time, maybe you need to review those notes and see what God was speaking in the message. See, there's so many disciplines in our lives, and we know to do them, but they're hard for us to do. These are things that we have to fight ourselves to do in order to win the prize, but it takes discipline. 1 Corinthians, the 9th chapter, turn there with me, a couple books back in 1 Corinthians, the 9th chapter this time. Great verse in the Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter number 9. 1 Corinthians chapter number 9, and it talks the very last part about all runners run, but only one will win the prize. Run in such a way that you may obtain it. Thus I run, not aimless, but this I fight, not as one who beats the air. And then last verse in chapter number 9, 1 Corinthians chapter number 9, verse number 27. Look at what he says. He says, but I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. What does he say? He's using boxing terminology here. He's just talked about running, but then he switched over to boxing. I'm not a fighter who just beats the air. I'm not somebody who's just shadow boxing. This is not a rehearsal. This is real life. I'm in the ring, and I'm fighting the good fight of faith, and I'm not the one who's missing punches and just beating the air. No, I'm the one who's disciplining. But the opponent here is myself. And he says, I discipline my body and bring it into subjection. The literal translation of that is I pummel myself and I make myself a slave. See, that discipline is a continuous beating. It's going after the same thing over and over and over and over and over again until finally there's bruising and there's bleeding and there's weakening until you bring it into subjection, into slavery, that I am not going to do the will of my body. My body is going to do the will of my soul and spirit, beating up again and again and again. It's a discipline. Not just empty, cold religion, but all of my heart going after the things of God. All that I am pressing on towards the prize. All that I have going into the resource of the kingdom of God. Why? Because there's a prize that's out there and I'm going to obtain it. Are you listening today? Sometimes we say, Pastor, I feel so alone in this and I don't know if I have the strength to do it. Listen, you have the power of the Holy Spirit and you have a loving church family around you that will encourage you. You need to get into arenas of faith. So I talked about fellowship is because there are people around you that can encourage you. And if there's something that you want in your life, you want to exemplify a certain virtue, God has given you, first of all, His Word. Remember, this is the compass. God's giving you the direction. If you want to have a heart after God's own heart, maybe you need to spend some time with King David. If you want to be a virtuous woman whose beauty comes from the inside, it might be time to spend some time with Sarah. If you want to be a successful leader in the business, in the marketplace, maybe it's time to go and see what Nehemiah was up to. If you want to be bold like Peter, it's time to get into the Gospels. See, these people are not just stories. These are people whose lives are an example and a pattern for us. Take a look at it with me in the book of Philippians. We'll close with this. Philippians chapter 3. You were just there a moment ago. Philippians chapter 3 once again. And this time we're going to go to verse number 17. A couple verses down from where he's talking about pressing towards the goal. Look at what he says in Philippians chapter 3, verse number 17. He says, "Brethren, join in following my example." Join in following my example. "And note those who so walk or live out their lives, as you have us for a pattern." See, I would love to spend time with each and every person in this church, but there's simply not enough time in the day or in the year or in my life to do that for everybody. So that's why when we spend time in the pulpit and when we spend time together in church, there's a pattern. There's a transparency, and I allow you into my life, and the preachers here do. Why? Because there's a pattern. But listen, it doesn't have to be all from one man. There are people in this church who are godly examples. Barbara and Dennis, my goodness, Mignon and others in this church, your ministry leaders, Ron, who I was pointing out, running up the stairs. My goodness, there are people of faith in this room who you can take a look at, and when you get close to them, the Bible says iron sharpens iron. There might be some heat, might be some sparks that fly, but man, you got around somebody and you said, "Man, I really want to have a better prayer life." And I heard them praying there at the altar, and you start to get around them and you start to listen to their prayers, and all of a sudden that little spark that you heard now lights a fire on the inside of you and your prayer life just ignites. Maybe you're saying, "I need to figure out how to study the Word," and you get into Bible college and listen to your instructors there. You get around people who know something about the Word of God. God has given us each other. He's given us His Word. He's given us His Spirit, and now we can press on towards the prize for the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Today, two things. Direction for life. Number one, get past your past, forgetting those things which are behind. We are none of those who turn away to our own destruction. But pressing on, number two, pressing towards the prize for the upward call. We are those who believe to the saving of the soul. Did you guys get something from the Word of God today? Come on, let's lift up a great big shout to the Lord. Hallelujah. Hey, let me talk to you guys before you leave. You guys have been great today. I want to thank you guys that stayed put. For those of you that left, I've got speakers out there in the foyer, down the breezeways, and even in the bathrooms. Hello. And so I want you to just listen up right where you are. God wants to talk to you. Let's talk. I want to talk to you about your eternal life. Everything that I talked about today is for people who are Christians. People who have the direction, they've been changed. The old man's dead and now the new man's alive and they're headed for heaven. That's who I was talking to in that message today. And sometimes people get a bit confused on how that happens. I want to clear up the confusion. I want to talk to you about your eternal life right now. Where would you end up? Just answer this question in your heart. Where would you end up if today was your last day on the earth? If this was your last day, you died, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? Just answer that question in your heart quietly. No one will know the answer but you and God. Your answer determines a lot about if you've got the right directions or not. Sometimes people answer that question, they say, "Well, Pastor, I don't believe in hell. That's like a fairy tale people made up to scare their children into being good. I'm not going to go there because it's not real." The problem with that thinking is, do you know that all throughout the Bible talks about hell? Old and New Testament? In fact, Jesus himself spoke of hell. It's a very real place. And you're not going to avoid it by denying its existence. You're going to have to deal with the reality of it. And listen, I don't want you to go to hell. You don't want you to go to hell. And listen, God does not want you to go to hell. Why else would he send Jesus beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross? God doesn't want you to go to hell. It was never intended for you or me. It was made for the devil and his angels. And so let's make sure today that you don't end up in hell, but that you get the right direction and that you head for heaven. Sometimes people say, "Well, Pastor, all roads lead to heaven. You know, Jesus went to the cross for that, and that's why all roads lead to heaven. You know, you just do your thing, I'll do my thing." Churches out there, however, they say, you know, as long as we stay true to ourselves, we're going to get to heaven. All roads lead to heaven. I don't got to worry about that. Problem with that is that's like saying all roads lead to the moon. You can't get there driving around the earth. You can drive around the earth as long as you want. You'll never make it. The same way, don't you think God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the one who wrote the plan of redemption, carried it out in his son Jesus, don't you think after going through the shame and the beating and the public scorn, of the cross, dying and pouring out his life, don't you think after doing all that, he would let us know how to get to heaven? Well, he does in his word. You know what? He doesn't say just do your own thing or stay true to yourself or whatever you think or they think or the churches think. He doesn't say it at all. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. What's that mean? It means it's God's heaven, and you're going to have to get there God's way. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, God's way is by being good. I know that if I'm just good enough, God will let me into heaven. It used to be bad, but I cleaned up my act. Now I'm good. I think my good now outweighs my bad, and I've given money to charities, been nice to my neighbors, you know, gotten involved in social justice causes and things like that. I've been a really good person. I think God sees that and appreciates that, and he's going to let me into heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say how good you have to be? How good is good enough? In fact, no one's going to get to heaven by being good, because the Bible says all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Can't get to heaven based on our goodness, because the standard is perfection, and the only one who is perfect, his name is Jesus. Not going to get to heaven based on your good works. In fact, the Bible says when we compare our good works with God's goodness, it's like filthy rags. Not going to get to stay. Sometimes people say, well, Pastor, don't you understand? In my lifetime, my parents raised me in church. As a child, took me to church every week, told me we were Christians. Hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck, had you baptized or christened as a child. Took you to religious classes like Sunday school or catechism class, maybe Sabbath school class. And you're born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhists, Muslim, Hindus. Therefore, we're Christians headed for heaven, denying hell, right? Wrong. Do you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say because you're raised in church, parents tell you you're Christian, that makes you Christian? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that you wear religious jewelry, attend religious classes, be baptized or christened as a child, or be born in America, that qualifies you for heaven. And again, I don't see anywhere in the Bible that because you're not some other religion, that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Listen, if that's how you think you're going to get to heaven, can I love you enough today, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth? You're not going to make it. Now, some of you might be thinking, well, Pastor, you don't understand. Not only when I was a child did I go to church, here I am sitting in church right now. I'm in church right here in front of you. And while I'm glad you're here today, could you just show that to me in the Bible where you sit in church service, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian? That's like me going home, sitting in my garage, calling myself a car, and that makes me a car. Now, we understand that. We say, no, you're not. No, you're just a person sitting in your garage. What makes us think we just sit in church, call ourselves a Christian? That makes us a Christian. You say, but Pastor, my last church, I got involved. I helped out. I sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I hadn't taught in the Bible classes, got a membership card to that church. That's great. I'm glad you did those things. Just show that to me in the Bible. Your church involvement gets you to heaven. Sing in the choir, help out, carry the pastor's Bible, make decisions. People think of you as a leader. You teach in the Bible class, you get to go to heaven. It's not there. God is not waiting at the gates of heaven looking for membership cards to a church before you can enter. Come on, let's talk about your eternal life. So he said, well, Pastor, okay, I got you on this one. Someone told me that if I know God, I'm a Christian. I know God. I know about Jesus. Celebrate Easter and the resurrection. Sing the songs of Christmas every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian because I know God? Well, if you'd read your Bible, you know the Bible says demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. The Bible says the devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth. So everybody look up here at me for a second. Look up here. This is not about what you have in your head. Having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is in your head, but not having him in your heart. See, Jesus said you must be born again if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term. They've raked it through the coals, made it out to be some weirdo, goofy stuff. Let's not let society and movies and television and Hollywood and the internet tell us what being born again means. Let's find out what being born again really means from the Bible. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, being born again has always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. All or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you in the last book of the Bible. Book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are pretty gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. But what's he talking about? Lukewarm, what's that? Well, it's a little in, a little out, a little up, a little down, a little token prayer every now and again, occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So today, I'm going to give you an opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, and pop my hands together. Now, when you hear the sound of my hands popping together, just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. Now, you might be thinking, whoa, whoa, whoa. Wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's push past that today. Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one made that trade. Yet the devil thinks you're so dumb, he's trying to talk you out of it right now. Listen, you just tell that devil, go jump in a fire lake. You're going on with God. Jesus said, if you confess me before man, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I will deny you. So today, your call, your choice. Will you give him all of your heart? Will you give him all of your life in this safe, friendly church service? Listen, and no one's criticizing, judging, or condemning you. We're all excited for you. We've all done this ourselves at one point or another, in one way or another in our lives. Now it's your turn. Will you give him all of your heart? Will you give him all of your life? Who should raise their hand? You've been running from God instead of to God. I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today you can make sure. Who should raise their hand? You never done this, never said yes to Jesus. Come on, I'm talking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place? You know that's the condition of your heart when I describe it. Get ready to get your hand up and make a right relationship with God. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at watching by television, in the foyer, the Love Rock Cafe, or online across the nation and around the world, ready to get your hand up. God sees and God's watching you. If you're here on campus, then tell an usher or come into the church service right afterwards, or online, you can click the button on our homepage, Respond to God or How to Know God. You see the blue button, you can click that. Someone will lead you in a prayer. Here we go. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. Need to give God all your heart. Need to give God all of your life. Thank you. There's one. There's two. There's three. There's four. God bless you guys. Who else today? Four wise people already. There's five. There's six. Got you over there. Thank you. Six, seven up on top. Thank you. Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody else? Oh, on this side. Seven. Where are you at? My goodness. I'm having a little trouble seeing you. Give me a little wave if you got your hand up. Thank you. Thank you. Got you right there. Seven, eight. On this side, nine. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. Nine wise people already. Where are you at? Number 10. Come on, you're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, yeah, you should. Let's go for it. Come on, that's you. Just raise it up high for me right now. Come on, number 10. Let's just take a moment. Wavery, thank you, 10. God bless you. Anybody else need to go for God today? Number 11, got you over there. Thank you. Who else today? 11 wise people already. I didn't embarrass them. I won't embarrass you. Come on, if you need to do this, let's go for it today. Just raise your hand up high. There's about 11 wise people. About 11 wise people. There's 12 up on top. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else in the family rooms? Anybody else? Anybody else on this side? Come on, let's just go for it today. There's a dozen wise people. Will you join them today? Know you need to give God all your heart. Know you need to give God all of your life. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right, well, let's give the Lord a hand for 12 wise people today. Hallelujah. God is so good. Now, hey, all 12 of you, or I believe there's eight more of you. You need to come. You little rascals. You should have raised your hand, but you didn't. Hey, it's not too late. We love you so much. We want to give you this opportunity as well. In a moment, we're all going to stand. We're all going to give a clap and a shout. As we do that, that's your cue. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, but you didn't, hey, here's for you too. Get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. I want you to get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies today. Can't do that till we get you down here. So, hey, you can bring your children. If they raise their hand, they'll remember this. Bring your stuff. Bring a friend if you need a friend. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, get in the aisle, get a friend if you need a friend, and get up here right now. Come on down. Come on down. Let's welcome them. You come right now. You come right now.
Jesus, I believe.
Come on, they're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come.
Jesus, I belong.
You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation.
You're the reason that I live.
They're still coming. Come on. There's room for you here. Come on down. Come on down. Come on. Come on. From the foyer, from the family rooms, just come on down. Come on right now. Just make your way to the front. Anybody else, if you need to come, you just make your way to the front right now. Come on down. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. They're still coming. If you need to come, just make your way to the altar right now. Just come on down. while I'm giving some direction here. Hey, you guys up front, put a big smile on your face. This is the best decision of your entire life. Gonna be born again, brand new. God's gonna make a new thing. Talking about that old man's gone, right? All that guilt and that shame from the past, wiped clean now. Now you got a new life in Christ. Right over here to my right, your left. See this guy waving at you? This man in black over here, good looking guy. Pastor Joel, he was the guy that put the tack in my hand. He's really a good guy, okay? Nothing weird's gonna go on. You know, sometimes you go to church, you wonder, are they weird? Listen, I'm about as weird as you're gonna encounter today, okay? He's cool. He's gonna do three things with you. Number one thing he's gonna do, he's gonna ask for your hand. No, he's not gonna ask for your hand, okay? He's gonna lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart, okay? You're gonna be born again. Secondly, he's gonna give you some free information, some free literature to find out what to do next in your walk with God. And then thirdly, he's gonna give you a friend that we have here in the church called the spiritual personal trainer, okay? Let me break it down to you like this. Just a friend in church who'll help you to get strong in the ways of the Lord. Remember we talked about getting around people that are ahead of you that can help you to get direction with God and press on towards the prize? Spiritual personal trainer will do that for you. They'll be that friend in church who will encourage you and sharpen you in the things of God so that you don't go back serving the devil, back to that old man and that old nature. Now you go on with God, pressing on towards the prize. So if you guys will make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.